One of the other things we did, and I'll show this real quick, is I changed some of the logic on the interlockings, at least where they had intermediate blocks preceding it or following it, to give those signals a yellow indication, basically when the train or the block, you know, two blocks away is occupied. So we'll just, for example, our test buddy here is gonna show it how it works. I'll do this clip here because he's gonna come through that signal over there at Wallace Junction. Then of course our intermediate up here goes on. But what it also does is it turns the signal here on the right-hand side there to yellow. And then as he comes around, it'll go red once he crosses underneath that block. So let me reposition this and we'll see how it works. I'll run them fast to get through, and you'll see. It's kind of neat to see how it works. All right, hopefully this works. Got the camcorder propped up here in the corner so you can see it. So what we're going to do is I'm going to run him out relatively quickly, so we don't take all your time all day. So he's going to come through the first lock, and that goes to yellow. As he speeds around here, he's going to come up, he'll go under the signal at 103, and as he does, hopefully that drops to red because he's then one block away. Alright, so now he's one block away. He's hustling through Lake City right now. Pretty soon he'll be coming around the bend. And here he comes. Well, that seems to work out pretty good. So obviously it also works in terms of following. So now he's over there, and as he goes around, he'll go through the block there at 94, and then this signal here should give an improved indication to yellow. So that means he's now, a block away. So that signal goes up to approach. And as he goes through the next, once he gets through the block over there in Pittsfield, I'll crank him up so he moves faster. That signal should then go to a clear indication as he clears the other block. And there we go. So I just put in that that logic to do that, just to give us, again, ideally this interlocking here would be red until a train approaches the signals, but I got to work on that next. But so far we're getting there, so I'm pretty happy where we are. I'm pretty happy with the overall progress and the logic, and at least we have some real, operational signals. Not totally prototypical, I understand that, but for now, as I learn the programming, we are indeed making progress. Alright, one more thing I decided to do here. Since we have the program running, I'm going to decide to put this the switch in here, the key switch. Showed this way back, a long time ago, several updates. I mean, way long time ago, but you put the key in, and right now it's locked, so if a crew comes in, nothing's going to happen. And we're looking at the turnout right here, which is the one that goes into the pit track over there. All right, so you got to come in, you got to obviously probably get permission, and then you can unlock it. Then, okay, I had it reverse. Now you can throw it back and forth. It's unlocked. I still got to do the programming for it, but I needed to get the hardware portion of it working first. So that works okay. And tomorrow I'll work on doing the programming for it. The key, for now, I just put it on a cute little tack. Just hang it right there. And let's just take a quick look underneath.
This little board I made up, coming from the key switch and the double throw. double pull, double throw switch up there. 12 volts for power, ground, and then it runs back to the actual tortoise itself. That's the tortoise right there. That's where it's wired. So those wire, I use a scrap piece of 6-conductor to wire it over. And so that's that. And the feedback back to the computer are these two right here, whether it's lock, unlock, and the actual position itself. And I verified that does work. That is reading in the program. But I don't have logic in the signals yet. Like I said, to control the signals, I'll do that tomorrow. So I got that done as well. City, I just put this in here for, since I was out wiring. I had to modify the turnout a little bit, but I brought all the leads that I need down to the terminal block, got them wired over, got the power and ground run over. So now it's just a matter of getting the panel on the fascia, getting the other key switch in. So I get as much done here as I could. I'm not quite ready to install that yet because I don't have the fascia, and I'm not sure if we're going to expand the other side, but I got the probably 80% of the work done here. So when I do put it in, it won't be that big a deal to get it all hooked up and working. Just like the switch over in Wallace Junction, this switch will work the same way.
All right, got the programming done last night. So here we are in the morning with our delicious cup of coffee. And we're here at the interlocking. And everything's set, locked, and normal. And of course, these signals are clear. This side's clear. And the way I have it now, I know this is not correct. This is totally, totally wrong, but they're both clear for now. Okay, so let's assume that our friendly neighborhood signal maintainer comes here to work on the switch, or something's going on, I don't know. So we put the key in, okay, and we unlock it. Now once we do that, that drops the corresponding signal on that track to stop, and it drops the corresponding signal on that track to stop. Okay, that's all well and good. And if I throw it reverse, and let's say I forget to, let's say I do that, so I go, I relock it, but I forget and leave it in reverse. I still have it set, same as the other end. It'll stay red. So you can't forget and walk away and have a problem. Of course, now it's not going to throw. So now I can throw it back. Now, the one, and I checked all a bunch of different situations and everything works fine. The one I'm not totally sure of, and I wonder if any prototype modelers out there could help me out here. You know, you come through this interlocking. And this switch is here. It was kind of an afterthought, so I didn't show it on this control panel. But what I did was, I basically, if I'm thrown this way to cross over here, and like I said, this turnout's right about here. If I'm lined this way, I kind of let the signals clear a move through the interlocking. For example, because if I come in here now, let's say I unlock it. You can see I let that signal stay red over flashing green. And I forget the exact indication, but so basically he can come through the interlocking and this switch is unlocked, but he's cleared to cross over. So I didn't know if that's really correct or not, if that's the way the prototype would do it. And then on this side, again, it's not right that they both would be, but again, since he's going to come in the interlocking, and he's going to come in and cross over and not, you know, be impacted by that switch, I let it stay that way. I don't know if that's right or not. Perhaps someone could tell me if that's correct or not. I don't know how the prototype would actually do that. I know if this is normal and you come in and you unlock this switch, I know you are okay to do a straight move on the other track, because I've seen that happen on the actual CSX. Similar situation just the other day. They have this, and they were dropping a car in here, and they had to unlock the turnout, and one train was working, in our case, on track two, and all the traffic was moving on track one. And they didn't have to stop and get permission past a stop signal or anything like that. So I think in this case, where everything's normal and we're unlocked, I think I have it correct. But I'm not sure what to do. Like I said, how that signal will indicate with an unlocked switch inside the plant and this turnout reverse. So you could move around that turnout either direction. I'm not sure how that would work. I do have it set. If you're thrown this way and you're unlocked, then that'll stop. This will go to stop. This is stop because the turnout's lined against you. So I do have that set up kind of automatically. I think even coming on this direction, you know, same thing, because you have to go through that turnout to get to the crossover. So I had that drop everything to red in that case. So I'm not sure. So if anyone out there is an actual has any ideas on that, or perhaps a prototype, a real railroader that might know how I'd handle that situation, let me know. It's simple to change in the code. Very simple to change it. So I'm just not sure what to do. So we finish up. We're back to normal. We unlock, and for now, we hang our keys next to it right there. So that's done, and that's programmed. Okay, one last thing I did, and this will be the final thing for this week's update. Like I said, got the programming pretty much done, and read a comment in one of the other videos, and someone who's got some programming knowledge had a great idea to actually make the text boxes basically change color and go bold. So I worked on that a little bit, and as you can see here, I do have that. Block 2 is occupied, block 5 is occupied. And now what happens, I'll just run a train along here. I have a train out there that I'm controlling from right here. I'm not sure you can hear that, but so I'm going to run him. He's going to go from block 5, and he'll come in into here. And that goes occupied. Changes color, goes bold. I love it. Now, the only thing I can't figure out is the next block, which is the last one I added, and the last text box, it will go bold, but I can't get the background color to change. So I have no idea what I'm doing wrong. See, it goes occupied, but I can't change the background color. And the code is exactly the same for all of these lines. And there goes block 9. And then as it clears, I realized that I had to actually go back and add basically an if-else statement, because otherwise, once it cleared, it would never change. It'll stay bolded and yellow. So he's going to come around here, block 9, and I'll crank him up a little bit. And then he's going to go from 9 into block 11, and then block 9 will clear. And it's visual, so it is kind of nice to have that. So now he's in both blocks, and he'll clear block 9. And block 9 clears. So that's pretty cool. So I like it. So thanks to Gary. That was a great tip. I do appreciate it. I also have it set for the turnout feedback. Normal reverse. If it's reversed, it goes yellow. And for the lock unlocks, if it goes unlocked, it goes red. But like I said, oh, there's our train. Yay! Like I said, for some reason, when I try to have that one particular block, this one right here, for some reason, it won't go yellow. I can't get the background to go yellow. And I'm telling you, I'm baffled. Again, I don't claim to be an expert on this. And this will probably won't do justice here. This is the code we had to go through, the code I went through. And you're not going to be able to see this, and probably most people don't even really care. But I don't know why, because it's the exact same thing I did for all the other ones. Here's the actual bunch of code right here that I added, and basically this just sets it. If it's clear, fill that text box with clear, else fill it with occupied. And then this makes the background, if it's occupied, make the background color yellow, else make it white. So I had to do that, and I just don't know why it won't go yellow. I really don't know. Maybe someone with BASIC can help me out. So, again, for some reason, I initially just had the first part of the statement, and I didn't have the else. And then, if you know, the logic would say it would set it to occupied. And then it came through the next time when it was clear, and it says, you know, if occupied, it fails that, so it falls right through, so it never changes it. So that's why I added this part here in the back. Or else, if the form, you know, if it's not occupied, then go back to being VB white. And that works for every single one of them, except the one we're looking at right here, which is that CPWJ1B. But the code's exactly the same. I did exactly the same as all the other blocks. I just did comment copy and pasting. And I don't know for the life of me why it doesn't do it. So when I run the program, like I said, this block here, which is the one in question, it will go bold occupied, but it won't go yellow. And all the other ones, like, you know, the train that just ran by is sitting here in this block, will go yellow and then clear when it leaves. And this one will clear. And by clear, I mean go back to CLR non-bolded. But I can't get the damn thing to turn yellow, so I don't know. Anyway, so that's the update. One little fine-tuning thing we did to it based on a comment from someone else who obviously has got much more basic experience than me. So thank you very much. Appreciate that. All right, so let's do a quick update where we are here. So for on the CMRI system, I'm ready to say that the system is now fully functional. All the inputs and outputs work. Everything reads properly. Block detectors, turnout positions, lock, unlock variables, everything reads correctly. And for the way I currently have it programmed, everything responds appropriately via the outputs to the layout. The only thing that really remains are some programming issues, and we'll cover that in a second here. So some of the things I want to do to kind of enhance things would be to add a fast clock in the program, just so we can, if we want to operate, we can kind of run through a day or a portion of a day. Add outputs to our Dream Player sound cards. We have three of them, and we have spare outputs. This might be tied in with the fast clock, so in the morning, you know, you hear birds chirping and roosters crowing and dogs barking and whatnot, and during the day it gets quieter, then in the evening again you hear the birds again and whatnot. So, and if you run at night, then you have night sounds, you know, the crickets and cicadas and all the night sounds and everything like that. So I want to tie that into the fast clock. And then obviously I want to add the railroad crossing up in Lake City. That'll incorporate a little bit of work calling the subroutine for the PGCC card, but shouldn't be too terribly difficult. Now, in terms of some of the program issues, what I really need to get to, and this is kind of an order of priority for me here, the biggest thing, and again, based on the way we're operating right now, it's really not correct. I need to get the CP signals all to display stop until traffic is in the block approaching the signal. And this, like I said, is based on the direction of traffic, I think. I'm struggling a little bit. The examples I've seen in the CMRI books, I understand them, but they're all very simple and they're single track. And I'm trying to incorporate it now with double track and multiple, you know, routes through an interlocking, and how do you get the direction of traffic set up appropriately. So I got to work on that one. So for now, everything works fine, but it definitely is not prototypically correct. I also want to get into, I do have it now, so if you're lined through a crossover, that you'll have red over flashing green. However, for the intermediate blocks, I'd like to have that then, especially if you have a following move, you know, one train goes through, it's red, he gets one block away, then it will go red over flashing yellow. Then when he clears that block, it would go red over flashing green. So I don't have this, and I have the red over flashing green, but not the flashing yellow. So I want to work on that. And then for all signals not already equipped or programmed, you know, have approach indications on several of the signals. If a train gets one block away, the signal goes green, and really it should be, you know, yellow approach. And these two are kind of tied in together. It's very similar. This is for when you're lined through a crossover. This would be if you're lined normal through it. So I do have some of this set up, like I said, for some of it already, but I want to do the rest of it because it looks a little goofy to have a train clear and you can still see the train one block ahead of you, but the signal's green. And for, you know, those of us that know a little bit about railroading, you know, that's not right. That signal should be approach, not clear. So that's what I want to work on. So that's kind of where we are and what we want to get to upcoming.